Hey, PreSales Collective, it's your host, James Kaikis, and today I'm going to be joined by Tia Hopkins, Vice President Global Solutions Architecture at eSentire. Tia is also the founder and CEO of Empower Her Cybersecurity. The topic of today's episode is establishing trust. And for pre-sales professionals, establishing trust with your prospects is mission critical in the sales process. But let's talk about trust with your account executives, with your managers, with your employees, and your teams. And so in today's episode, Tia and I are going to talk about trust organizational-wide, what it is, why it's important, and some actionable takeaways for you at the end of the day to instill trust within your customers, your employees, and your teams. Enjoy. Today's episode is sponsored by Proverity. In this highly competitive, ever-changing environment, it is key to show continuous value. Proverity Cloud does just that by providing the necessary collaboration, crucial data, and real-time insights throughout the customer lifecycle so that pre-sales teams can remain agile and can unlock sustainable revenue growth. For more information, visit proverity.com. Tia Hopkins, welcome to the PreSales Podcast. How are you?
I'm good. Thanks for having me.
You are no stranger to the PreSales Collective. We've known each other since pretty much the first month of PreSales Collective, where you've been involved in a number of webinars and events for us. So it's my pleasure to have you on the podcast today.
It's always a pleasure hanging out with you, Jay.
So Tia, before we get into today's topic, you and I were discussing previously that you've got some really exciting things happening at work. So could you tell me a little bit about what's happening with your role and your org structure?
Up until recently, I led the global pre-sales team, and the one team was responsible mostly for the pre-sales function and then a bit of post-sales in terms of handing off to project managers, et cetera. I've since built that out into a separate team for the post-sales function that is specifically dedicated to a successful handoff, engineering the outcomes that the customers, you know, were looking for when they decided to choose us as a solution. And I've also taken on the team that's responsible for supporting the technology that we leverage to deliver our service. So my purview, so to speak, has gone from strictly pre-sales to the end-to-end solution design and implementation. And I think that's a really big deal when it comes to engineering the entire customer journey to drive the outcomes that they're looking for.
That's incredible, Tia, because this is something that I'm looking at from the pre-sales collective lens is like, what is org structure? What is the pre-sales organization of the future? What or where should this team live? And the fact that you've actually taken on these post-sale functions is something that I believe is going to be more and more of a common trend. So what was the rationale for you to go and look to combine the teams together?
It started with, you know, I'm at a high growth company. So it started with, I need to scale my team. And the reality as a pre-sales leader, as you know, when the sales team goes out and hires 15 new sales reps, you can't hire 15, you know, solution architects or sales engineers. So I was like, how is my team going to do more with less? And what made the most sense to me, and it solved for a couple of problems, right? It was take off the post-sales responsibility, but also at the same time, put more of an emphasis on the post-sales journey for those customers. And so you have technical resource talking to technical resource. So your pre-sales resource has all the information about the infrastructure, skill level, what's the team makeup, why did they even go with us, what do they care about, hand that off to another resource that has all the information around service delivery and best practices, et cetera. And they just hit the ground running and it's a much better experience. Because those first 100 days, that kind of sets the tone for what that relationship is going to be like. It's either a fantastic experience and you have some room to get over some bumps, or it's bumpy from the start. And no matter what you do, you just can't manage to get within the good graces.
I love that you're positioning your organization this way, because something that I've talked about on multiple buyer enablement podcasts is the fact that our BDRs and AEs do disco, our SEs do disco. You sign a contract and then all of a sudden the implementation and partners will ask the same questions that you've already been asked two or three times in the sales process. And you're right. You get off on the wrong foot. It's bumpy right from the get-go. So I love that eSentire is streamlining the customer experience. And I'm really excited to see what the progress looks like 6, 9, 12 months from now.
I'm excited, and we've actually wrapped a program around the post-sales function. You know, one thing I've learned, and it's fantastic being in sales, is when you want to get something done, you really have to sell it. to the business. But there was something really great that came out of this. We built a program called the Cyber Risk Advisor. So this post-sales function will be responsible for the deployment, but also working with the customer to make sense of all the security information that we have in their environment and being their single point of contact for like anything. Like the recent Kaseya breach would have been able to call this resource up and say, hey, what does that mean in my environment, right? Because there's just a lot of data out there, and we find that a lot of our customers struggle to put it together in a meaningful way.
I'm excited again to see the progress of the team and the integration of the team. But let's talk about you a little bit before we get into today's episode. Tia, how did you get into pre-sales?
Oh, I fell into it. I think that's the story I hear, you know, most of the time. I've never spoken to anyone that said, yep, when I went to college, I knew I wanted to be in pre-sales, and that's what I studied. So the funny thing, though, is all of the roles that I've had, even the ones that weren't necessarily pre-sales, have been customer facing. So you learn how to listen, you learn how to talk, you learn how to satisfy, right? And that makes for a pretty successful pre-sales individual. So when I pivoted into cybersecurity, I went into a systems engineer role, which was deployment focused. And then they put me on one call where I had to talk a customer through something. They were like, that's it. You're doing pre-sales from here on out. And that's how it happened. I really wanted to stay in the world of hands-on, but I guess consulting is in my blood. And here I am.
Such a great journey. That's fantastic. Well, Tia, let's get into today's topic, establishing trust. So many organizations talk about trust as one of the core tenets and core values to the organization, to the sales process, to people. But to you, why is trust so important in sales?
Trust is important in sales because the more information you have, the better a solution you can position, you know, that's going to meet the needs of the customer. But if you don't have that trust, it's likely that they're not going to share as much with you as is necessary for you to design that optimal solution. And especially in the world that I live in of cybersecurity, you know, it's not like I'm selling storage, so I could kind of figure things out. The more I know about that environment, the more I can help. So if I'm not able to establish trust, I'm not going to get what I need. A non-technical example of that is if I go to someone's house and say, hey, I want to put a security system in your home, but before I do that, you got to show me where all the holes are. Show me where someone can break in. And I'm going to look at you like, that's not going to happen, right? So you do have to establish that relationship, that rapport, to make buyers feel comfortable opening up.
And that was actually going to be my follow-up question to you is, trust is absolutely pivotal in really building a relationship with somebody in the sales process. And you talked about it with cybersecurity, networking. It's got to be next level because IT professionals, technology professionals tend to be a little bit more risk adverse in that perspective. What tactics have you utilized to really break in with that type of crowd? Because I think when we think about trust from like a MarTech or a CRM type technology to a very technical solution, it is two different things.
It is really, and this might sound cliche, but I am in hardcore listening mode at the beginning of engagements because whether you've established trust or not early on, this buyer already has in their mind the amount of information they're going to share with you. And that's what you've got to work with. And so I take all of that in, I process it, I pull out, hey, what is it that this buyer really cares about? And what value can I add? That's always my primary way to wedge into the process. Where can I add value? What haven't they thought about? What haven't they talked about? And whether that's relative to the solution that I'm selling or not, it's, hey, have you thought about this? Or I read this the other day and thought this might be applicable to your environment. And so driving that perception that you care, not just about selling them something, but actually solving their problem, right? In order to understand what that problem is, you really, really do have to listen, and you have to listen to solution, not listen to sell. I've seen that get folks in trouble time and time again.
I love that, Tia. I think that's so well said. And it gets me thinking, with sales generally, we talk a lot about the day of the informed buyer, people doing their homework. And I tend to believe it's because salespeople generally have gotten a bad reputation over the past couple of decades due to selling snake oil or vaporware. And really what's happened is that the pre-sales professional are the ones that have become the trusted advisor. Is that a generalization from my point, or do you think what sales was over the past couple of decades has actually led us to this point where trust is so important in the process?
I mean, I think it's always important, especially in cybersecurity. I haven't seen where the sales rep necessarily has, like, you know, a bad rep and they're like, oh, you're just here just to sell me something. Or I've also heard the phrase, oh, showing up with commission breath or things like that. That just can't be the tone, right? It's so much more important than that. And so the pre-sales resources are still seen as the authority, right? Like the voice of truth. Is this going to work? What should I be thinking about? But I do find that sales reps establish credibility from, I would say, a light technical perspective as well, because you can't go into a conversation, sales, pre-sales, regardless, and not understand their business, how they're impacted by regulatory compliance, or what they're beholden to meet the needs of their customers, et cetera. You have to be able to hit on those points. So there is a bit of responsibility on both parts in the cybersecurity industry to be able to have those conversations in a meaningful way.
I think the term that comes to my mind is credibility. Anytime I've ever worked in software sales, MarTech, whatever it was, I always feel like my AEs needed to come to the meeting with a level of credibility. When they walked into the meeting and said their name and said their position and said, here's my smart person, they're going to lead the demo, I always thought it killed credibility. It moved that level of trust from the account executive to the sales rep. So to your point, when account executives come in with a point of view, establishing business needs, setting a level of credibility, it allows for the team to be a little bit more dynamic in building trust together versus just the pre-sales professional. Is that a right assumption?
It is. And it's important because while pre-sales is seen as the voice of truth, the authority from a technical perspective, I still find that buyers don't commonly look at that resource as understanding the business side of it. So that is where the sales rep has the opportunity to establish credibility. And again, back to my point in cybersecurity, it's not just buying a tool, no matter what industry you're in, you're going to need. It's you really have to understand my business in order to really get through this conversation with me and understand what my needs are. And oftentimes the sales rep is leaned on for that. And then the pre-sales resource comes in to kind of knock it out of the park and tie into all of those things that were discovered.
So I'm going to put you in the hot seat a little bit, Tia, and get your perspective here. With Pre-Sales Collective, we talked a lot about, should the sales engineer be tech savvy or business savvy? And as you just mentioned, sometimes our customers don't look at our sales engineer or pre-sale resource as business savvy. But do you think that the role is shifting from tech savvy to business savvy, or is there a balance of both that's absolutely needed for this role as it evolves?
There is a balance that's needed. When I look for the unicorn pre-sales resource, it is someone that has the business knowledge and can carry those conversations, but also has the technical knowledge and can carry those conversations. But the key is having the ability to slide the lever whichever direction you need to in order to appropriately address the audience that you're speaking with. Now, that said, I'm finding that the definition of technical is where the hairs are kind of needing to be split, right? Because does that mean going down the rabbit hole with features and functionality? Or does that mean tying the technical aspects of your solution back to the business outcomes? And my belief is that it's the latter, because telling someone everything that a solution can do is not telling them how that solution is going to solve their problem. And that's where the business aspect comes in, because you can't join those two if you don't have that business acumen.
We recently had an article on the blog about how you evaluate a pre-sales professional in the interview process, and looking at that sliding scale that you mentioned of tech savvy versus business savvy. But I like that you said that that lever has to move based off who you're speaking to. It's very, very great point. And some of the things that we've been talking about is this term called co-pilot in sales process. And we actually had Doug Landis, who's a growth partner at Emergence Capital, a venture capitalist firm, talking about the pre-sales role, and says that that role really needs to become this co-pilot in the go-to-market organization to have its true seat at the executive table. But I want to get tactical here for a second, Tia. What are some ways that you teach or educate your teams on being that trustworthy co-pilot in your sales process and to these customers?
My perspective is that our sales team That's our primary customer. So the same way you go into the sales process, looking to establish trust, credibility, build rapport, you have to do that with your sales rep. Your sales rep needs to want to take you everywhere they go, right? You need to strive to have to push back and say, well, do I really need to be in that meeting? You don't want to be on the side of, hey, what's going on, right? And it's the same thing with the buyers. It's about adding value. What are the things that you do in a meeting that your seller just can't do? Because we all know that our sellers will listen to us talk and pick up things that we say. I've found myself in meetings where I'm all teed up, ready to start my spiel, and my seller has taking 80% of what I would have said because, you know, he's heard me say it so many times. And I'm like, well, what am I going to say now? And I'm just building that, you know, as we go along. But it does come back to how much confidence your seller has in you. And that confidence comes down to how do buyers respond to you? Are they believing in what you say? And are you able to handle the hard questions? And that really comes with honing your craft, as cheesy as that sounds. Like in cybersecurity, understand what's going on in the industry. What are the trends? What are the latest breaches? I've been in conversations where we're kind of talking through their security stack and they mention a specific technology and I'll go a different direction and talk about that technology for a second and ask them, hey, do you have these components that'll really help you level up in this area, you know, of your security program? And they didn't expect that because I'm there to talk about something wildly different. So I know I kind of long-winded answer, but same approach to the seller as to buyers, because it is about establishing trust with them as well.
You know, I think that's a very underrated point in pre-sales. This is one thing that I've seen in my career is that a lot of people and teams tend to not remember that their sales rep or their account executive is really the main person that they need to be building a relationship with. Because at the end of the day, the end customer can tell when the sales team's not on the same page or there's friction in that relationship. And I think it really comes through, right? It absolutely comes through. Let me shift gears a little bit. When we talk about establishing trust and building trust, what happens when you break trust, especially in the pre-sales process? Have you ever had a situation where someone on your team maybe broke trust with a customer or prospect? How did you handle that situation? How did he or she rebound from that situation?
That's a tricky one because my motto has been don't break. So we've had situations where, you know, things get hairy. You think you heard one thing and it was another. Or the customer thought they asked you for something and you answered a certain way and the solution comes back and it's something else. But it really is about bend, don't break. Because, I mean, I feel like if it breaks, and you're not the only vendor or service provider that they're talking to. So, I mean, chances are they're going to pivot and go a different direction. But if there's a bend, you have the opportunity to fix whatever it is. You know, I mean, I've had several situations where there are things that we need to talk about in terms of being able to properly deploy or being able to deliver on some of the asset that the buyer has. And an answer was given maybe when a bit more qualification was required, right? And the last thing you want to do is extend the sales cycle. And, you know, sales reps get really nervous about, do we really need to talk about that? And it's not about pulling the wool over buyers' eyes, but you really have to walk that line between what are the things that I absolutely need to talk about to basically not hurt my credibility, the company's credibility, et cetera, but also not instill doubt because a confused mind always says no. So you want to instill confidence. You don't want to confuse anyone. But then, you know, there are situations where that happens where, no, we really need to talk about this thing, or do we really need to talk about this thing? And we're trying to get back to the buyer with an answer. And it's taken a while because you have to figure out the best way to position it. But it is all about working together. Everyone's got to bend. Everyone's got to give. On the pre-sale side, we may not be able to go as far as we want to go. And on the sales rep side, we may have to go a little further than you want to go. But at the end of the day, it's about the buyer, right? And the outcomes that they're going to experience once they sign on the dotted line.
I love the motto, bend, don't break. I mean, it's really well said. And you're right. You do what you have to do to make that customer successful at the end. For you as a leader, how do you then, in those tough situations, balance the line of trust where you kind of enable your team to get through a situation, but also want to solve and make sure that you're doing what's right by the customer by not risking the business? Do you have a philosophy on how you approach those situations?
I do. I mean, I'm a servant leader. First off, I'm here to prop my team up, make sure they have everything they need to be successful. So in situations like that, I get the download. Hey, what happened? Where did we go wrong? And then I always ask, what do you think we need to do? Because I don't want it to seem like I'm just always coming over the top and saying, nope, we're going to do this, we're going to do that. Because there's a couple of things. One, when you ask the individual on your team to solution through it with you, it's an opportunity for growth for them. And it's also an opportunity for you to then, as a leader, build more trust with this individual, because they don't feel like you're just going to come down on them every time something goes wrong. It feels more like a team. The other part of that for me is I am not in the situation. I find that getting updates on deals is like a game of telephone. And the further you are removed from the deal, the less details you have. And we all know the devil's in the details. So if I ask my resource to solution through this, there's probably going to be some incredibly relevant small details that are going to be in their head that are going to help us get to a better solution than I would have on my own. So I fully believe in working through it together and making sure they're taking all things into consideration, right? The deal, their seller, the customer, the business, just making sure they're thinking about everything. And then we can always get to a solution that is agreeable.
I really love the approach, and I totally respect the servant leadership aspect and the asking of questions. Have you ever had a scenario where one of your managers broke trust with their employees and you almost had to step in?
I think there's been situations where there are perceptions of that. I'm really like big on semantics and, you know, splitting hairs, et cetera. I don't think it has ever been intentional that a manager has broken trust, but I think situations and breaks in communication create that perception. And so what I find in all of these situations is there's just always some communication breakdown somewhere that just needs to be repaired. And you can usually get folks on the right track. It's usually, I said this thing, I didn't mean it that way. Oh, but I heard it this way. Well, let's talk about this. And another thing is technical resources tend to get wrapped around the axle in the weeds and you got to pull them out. All right. So we're talking about all the details of this situation. But when we started out, what exactly were we trying to achieve? Where were we trying to go? Let's focus on that. Let's pick out the piece that prevented us from getting there and figure out how to move forward from there. Instead of going down this rabbit hole of all the things that happened that didn't work, let's pick out the one thing that will work and move forward.
As an executive, you're taking on multiple teams and multiple organizations. You're essentially building trust with the employees downward as you take on these new roles and responsibilities. And you also have to build trust upwards with finance or your CRO to say, hey, this is what we're doing and this is why we're doing it. What are some ways that you employ building trust upwards? Because this is a big initiative for you. There's a lot of responsibilities that come with this kind of organizational change, but it can have a massive positive impact on the organization. And I think trust plays a big factor in it.
Another philosophy of mine is every call is a sales call. When I started at East Entire, my director at the time said that to me, and I didn't know what he meant at the time. But as I grew in my role and grew in general, I started to understand that. And so I've taken that on as a major philosophy of mine. Every call is a sales call, and everyone that I speak to is a potential buyer. And so in order for me to get them to buy into whatever it is in that situation, whether I'm trying to position my solution for you, whether I'm trying to position the growth of my team, or if I'm trying to position a new project that the team has to take on, if I'm managing down, it is communicating in a way that the individual or group that you're speaking to is going to relate to what it is that you're saying. And I like to sum that up by saying, just make sure you communicate in a way that's going to allow them to pick up what you're putting down. That comes back to get to your question of managing up, basically. I have to understand the pressure points, the triggers, like what do my leaders care about? And that's how I have to communicate to them, right? Like I can't go to my CFO talking about product concerns. I have to go to my CFO and translate those product concerns into financial terms of the business. And so, you know, one thing I say to my team and to anyone that I get the opportunity to say this to, you have to pay attention to how the person you're speaking to is listening. So I can't speak in bits and bytes when I'm speaking to someone that's listening in dollars and cents. And conversely, I can't speak to a team that's all about bits and bytes about dollars and cents. They don't care about that. So I'm all about learning the individual. How can I make their job easier? How do I need to communicate to them? Because it just makes my job easier when I don't have to go back to the drawing board 10 times because they just can't process what it is I'm trying to put out there.
Tia, you just dropped the mic. I feel like I should just stop the episode right there. Pay attention to how someone is listening. You can't talk about bits and bytes if they're listening in dollars and cents. I mean, that's so well said. That's incredible. And it's the truth, right? Speaking the customer's language, and that customer could be an internal stakeholder or external. I want to ask you one final question about your new organization. So again, congratulations to you. I'm super excited for you. I know this is well-deserved. In terms of trust, this seems to me like a move to really make customers successful from the pre-sales process to the post-sale to the ongoing continued support. How do you convey that message to your organization downward of this is why we're making this change and this is the impact? Does it use trust? Is it trust at the center of what this is? Is it customer success? What is it?
It is trust at the center of it because it stretches from pre-sales into customer success. And we still have a separate customer success team. You know, I've got to get buy-in from all over the business. And for me, establishing that trust comes down to being transparent. Don't just come down saying, this is what we're going to do. And that's it. Explain why. Explain where we were, where we are today, where we're trying to go, how it helps support the business and ensure all of the functions understand how they play into the success of the business, right? It's not just about coming to work every day and, you know, checking off your list of tasks. Like, you are driving a much larger initiative forward. And I find that the more employees understand their part, the more you get buy-in and the more they feel like they actually have a stake in it, they have a say, like you're listening to their feedback, you're answering their questions, the more comfortable they are and the more confident they are in their roles and the more they want to do.
Tia, that's great advice. I really like what you had to say here. And I'm so excited to watch the journey that happens at eSentire with this organizational move. I continue to believe that this type of move is the right organization structure for the pre-sales profession. So glad to see that you're leading the way and we're rooting for you and continued success in the new role.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
All right, Tia, thanks for joining the pre-sales podcast. I'll see you next time.
All right.
All right, pre-sales collective. Tia is no stranger to the pre-sales collective. She's been on a number of pre-sales collective webinars as a guest and a host. And so it's my honor and privilege to bring her to the pre-sales collective podcast. Tia gave a ton of great advice today. And just to start off, she talked about the idea of solving problems versus selling and that mindset for the pre-sales professional and how we as pre-sales professionals can swing from the tech savvy to the biz savvy based off who we're speaking to. I mean, that is mission critical and important. And as we talk about what is the role, is it tech savvy? Is it business savvy? It really is a combination of both. But more importantly, when do you use it based off who you're speaking to? And every call is a sales call. And everyone that we speak to is a buyer. I love that philosophy of Tia. And it comes out in every conversation that I have with her. I love that she talked about pay attention to how someone is listening. If someone is listening in dollar and cents, you can't speak bits and bytes. If they're listening in bits and bytes, you can't speak in dollar and cents. As simple as that sounds, it is so hard to do in actuality. So understanding our audience, understand who we're talking to and how we position it. And I like that Tia discussed establishing trust within our organizations, up, down, left, right. And really she talked about our sales counterparts as they're our number one customer. And from our examples of trust goes a long way when you have a solid working relationship with your account team and your selling team in terms of how that end experience is for the buyer. And for Tia, she is on a journey with a massive organizational shift happening. How does she instill trust in the team, in the organization, and into her leaders as well in terms of how this role and how this organizational shift is going to make an impact on the business? All right, Pre-Sales Collective, I hope you enjoyed today's episode. If you haven't given us a review, I would really appreciate it. Share the podcast with your friends or your colleagues. Share it to somebody who might need to listen to this episode. As always, I will see you next week.